Listening Library presents Clarice the Brave by Lisa McMann. Read for you by Alexa Magro. Mutiny. I'd heard that word before. Sailors whispered it on the mess deck where my brother and I lived in the corner of a wooden crate the color of a November cornfield. They muttered it like an oath late at night after an extra dram of grog. They sent it, quiet, like a prayer, through the ripe silence between slaps of the whip or thuds to the ribs from a thick boot. I'd heard it, but I hadn't grasped what it meant, or what it would mean for us. It was just a word. Our crate was filled with burlap sacks of coffee beans, slowly going stale in the locked pantry off the galley. The padlock didn't affect us. We could squeeze under the door easily enough, but it kept out the sailors and the cats. Only Heyu, the pasty-skinned kitchen boy, who wore the key on a chain around his neck, came and went several times a day, fetching things for the cook. Nevertheless, we two were safe most of the time, and we had food available. After watching everyone around us die, that's really all we wanted. My brother, Charles Sebastian, and I were the only ones left of our family. Our siblings had been taken by disease or eaten by special lady, who was one of three horrid ship cats. She spent most of her time in the galley near the cook, awaiting a lurch that might cause a scrap of food to fall into her gaping maw. She was the captain's pet, a dreadful thick orange thing, always trying to sneak into the pantry behind the kitchen boy. She ate our sister Olivia. Olivia's death had come as a jolt, for she'd been the strongest and fastest of the litter. Her failure to outrun Special Lady weighed heavily on me. If she couldn't survive, how could I? Was it only a matter of time? The thought was paralyzing. "How have you made it this long, Mother?" I'd asked soon after, back when she was still with us. "Some of it was luck, little bean," Mother had admitted. Then she'd examined me carefully, as if able to see the clouds of worry that pressed behind my eyes. "An understanding that hiding can be a better choice than fleeing." After she'd said it, she'd glanced worriedly across the pantry at my brother. Charles Sebastian had an especially strong instinct to run, which led to him sometimes losing his head. The rest of us were constantly trying to teach him how to control his impulses. Was she concerned that he'd be next? "What if we fail?" I said, feeling faint. "What if we run when we should hide?" Her warm breath bathed my ear. "Clarice," she said, "when I was young, about to set off alone to see the world, I had a lot of doubts. Leaving my family was hard, but the call of adventure wouldn't stop just because I was scared. On the night I left to stow away on this ship, my father told me something that helped me worry less during the darkest times." "What was it?" I could hardly get the words out fast enough. Her sad whiskers, mourning Olivia, turned slightly upward as she remembered. "He said, it only takes one mouse to believe in you. And that one mouse is me." I felt a rush of warmth. "And what did you think of that?" "It made me feel strong and confident in my decisions. I repeated those words whenever I doubted myself or felt alone in the world." She stared off into the dark pantry, reminiscing. I can still hear my father's voice. Then she looked at me. "And I want you to know that I believe in you as much as my father believed in me." My mother's sincerity in that moment had made my heart swell. I already knew that I made good decisions most of the time, but her words buoyed my confidence in a way I hadn't realized I needed. Moments later, she'd called Charles Sebastian to go with her on a hunt for fresh water. Perhaps she'd wanted a quiet moment to encourage him in the same way. We'd never know the answer, though, for on that trip, Mother was doused by a rogue wave and swept overboard. Gone in an instant. Charles Sebastian returned alone, shaken to the core. The pantry felt twice its size without her presence to fill it. My mother loved the sea, but I despised it. Her death gave me even more reason to hate it. Water is deceptive. It seems soft, but it isn't. A wave's unexpected slap is enough to break a poor mouse's neck. Charles Sebastian had seen it happen. After that, he refused to leave the pantry, and I returned to my doubts. If our own seafaring adventurer mother couldn't survive, what chance did we have? Without her, we stayed in our crate, more scared than ever. We sat huddled together, slept curled together, and ate what we could find together. Only I ventured out for water in the dead of night, collecting drips for my brother in the curve of a broken wooden spoon that I gripped between my teeth. There was nothing else that could get us to leave our safe crate now. Nothing but that word. One day, when the pantry door opened and Heyu peered into our dark room, a sinister feeling crept in with the fresh sea breeze. It made my fur stand on end. Charles Sebastian froze, then shook. He clamped his mouth onto the bottom slat to chew, which he often did to ease his anxiety. His teeth were admirable, and I was envious of his strong jaw. Gnawing was essential for mice. It got us into places and out of them, a key component to survival. I peered out, looking for cats, but I didn't see any of the monstrous beasts.
"Hey, you!" bellowed the cook from the galley.
"Yes?" said Heyu, turning his pimply face to look at him.
"Grind up some coffee beans. It's going to be a long night."
The boy's eyes widened, but I couldn't guess why. "Tonight?" he said on a breath. The cook didn't respond, or at least not loudly enough for us to hear. Heyu came into the pantry. We crouched in the corner of our crate, small as we could be, while the boy hovered over us, his leg a mere tail's length away. The metal coffee scoop crackled as it bit into the goods. It scraped the burlap sack against our fur, and the beans shifted uneasily. Charles Sebastian flattened beneath me and trembled so hard that I thought he was about to bolt. "Fight the urge," I wanted to tell him. But was it better to run? I was more unsure than ever, and doubts crept and curled in with the fear. My mother's story rang in my ears, and her father's words became her words to me. "It only takes one mouse to believe in you, and that one mouse is me." I pinched my eyes shut until stillness and darkness returned. But it wouldn't last. Something bad.
"Clarice?" whispered Charles Sebastian sometime later. His trembling had dissipated to a slight but constant shiver.
Noises were loud above us. The creaking and groaning of the ship and the boots of the sailors seemed especially heavy.
"Yes, brother," I said. "I'm here."
"The sailors seem more flurious than usual."
"Full of flurry," I thought he meant. "Rushing about?"
"Yes."
"The air prickles."
"Does it?" I rose and scraped my paw between his ears to soothe him like mother used to do. She'd favored him. We all did. As the runt of the litter, he'd always been a bit precious, or at least we treated him that way, and he allowed it. Mother once fancied the idea that Charles Sebastian had the gift of future sight. She was very romantic that way, much like with her dreams of seeing the world. I was more pragmatic, and it was clear Charles Sebastian possessed no such gift. After all, he hadn't predicted the giant wave that took our mother away. He hadn't foreseen Special Lady pouncing and grabbing our dear sister Olivia and darting off while the poor thing was still squealing. I'll never forget that sound, nor the end of it. If anything, Charles Sebastian possessed more intelligence than the rest of us combined. But he lacked common sense. Perhaps that was what led to his constant state of fear. I'm sure our coddling didn't do him any favors. Charles Sebastian blinked rapidly.
It's happening,
he said.
What is?
He didn't answer, but I knew.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.